και πάλι από το Olympia Forum σε ένα πολύ ενδιαφέρον τετατέτ. Θα συναντήσουμε τον Δήμαρχο Τυράννων, τον κύριο Ερίον Βελία, που έχω ακούσει πραγματικά για όλη τη μετάλλαξη που υπάρχει στην πόλη των Τυράννων. Αν θέλετε χρησιμοποιήστε τα ακουστικά για τη μετάφραση, διότι η συζήτησή μας θα γίνει στα αγγλικά. Welcome to Athens, welcome to Greece.
It's always a delight to be back. Thanks for having me. Ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ.
We have a common friend. It's a Greek artist, Christos Papanikolaou, coming from Larissa, actually. And he told me about the transformation of the city of Tirana. What happened there? What synthesized that transformation?
Well, we've come a long way, and Christo is one part of the transformation. Tirana now is home to 144 municipalities, citizenships. People from across the world have made a home. We have over 20,000 Italians. Can you believe that in 1989, we were the most isolated country in the world? We were the North Korea of Europe. The country looked like a mess when, you know, I took over the city hall. The illegal construction, the rush to go to the capital. It started as a small village, 10,000 of 10,000 people, about 100 years ago. It became an accidental capital, and now it has grown 100 times.
A century before, it was just 10,000 people?
It was just 10,000 people. The government was in Durres. The fascist army comes in when the government was away for a congress, and they were looking for a temporary home for the government. So they came to this village called Tirana for 5 days. And then they ended up staying for 5 weeks. And then for 5 years, it became the capital. During the fascist period, it got the government infrastructure. But then we went from a country that had only 170 cars during communism for the Politburo and for the army. It became a country of 200,000 cars. I came to Greece when I was 10 years old. I lost my father. My mom had two of us. My brother was four, so she took care of him. I came illegally here across the border to Ioannina, and then was welcomed by a Greek family.
In what age?
It was quite an experience, yes. And then my Greek is very limited from the time. But then I understood the psyche of someone who leaves the North Korea, Europe, to come back with a trophy. And the trophy was the automobile. So people come to Greece, buy old Nissan, a pickup truck, and bring it home. Or go to Germany, bring a Mercedes, or go to Italy and bring a Fiat. So then we became a city that was choked with cars. And from a city where, you know, even in the old days, people were walking and meeting and have a sense of intimacy, we went into a city that was overwhelmed. And as you saw in the slides, what I found as my number one job was a traffic jam in front of the city hall. And we say, how do we change this? Usually, you are advised as a politician to only think about the voter and the taxpayer. We said, we're going to change this. We're going to talk to children. So initially, we started with some car-free days to block some roads. You can always be suspicious as a journalist or as any person. You can always be suspicious of a politician. But you cannot be suspicious of your own child. So if your kid comes home and you are saying crazy things about the mayor, but the kid says, I had so much fun in a car-free day in the downtown, completely close to traffic, let's make it permanent. And then children become completely unusual advocates of what you're trying to change in the city. So the project you see in the background is how we turned the largest roundabout for cars in the Balkans into the largest open car-free space, full of life, full of activity, full of stars, full of humans of all ages. So I think, in my view, the human-sized city is the synthesis. Because if the city has the size of a human, whether it is the square, whether it is the market.
Mr. Mayor, that wasn't the plan coming from the technocrats, but you heard before the needs of the community.
Look, technocrats,
or both.
Technocrats get a lot of blame. And yes, bureaucrats are that category that deserve some blame. But technocrats and believe in science is very important. In today's world where people are saying, I have alternative facts, alternative science, alternative realities, this is crazy. During communism, I mean, look at the discussion we have in Greece and Albania, everywhere, about the vaccine. We are doubting science. During communism, we had less information, but we knew more. One of the reasons that no one from us here has a friend with polio is because everybody took those two drops and no one has polio anymore. So to give some credit to the technocrats, they were important in implementing the vision. But I think we could not have won the battle of transforming the city with technocrats alone. Sometimes you have to look for completely unusual advocates, and they come in a form of non-voters, non-taxpayers, sometimes called children, that can do a better advocacy than the technocrats.
We should ask children, but given the definition of an ideal city.
I think I mentioned it before, the ideal city, it has to have the size of a human. Jane Jacobs used to say, the city should be full with eyes on the street. As human beings, we're not constructed to be imprisoned in a metal box called the automobile. The cars have been existing only for the last 100 years. For millions of years, we were walking and running, birds were flying, and fish were swimming. So sitting in traffic like this is not our natural state. So the question is, how do we make this transition? And how do we make a human-sized city? I think building quality agoras, and I'm borrowing a Greek concept, because the agora is where everybody feels equal. A beautiful boulevard, a beautiful square, a beautiful playground. It doesn't matter whether you're rich or poor, whether you're from an important family or you're nobody. It's an equalizer. And I think good cities are human-sized cities where they have portions of the city. You cannot eradicate inequality. Communism tried this in Albania. It failed miserably. Everybody was equal, but everybody was poor. So in capitalism, yes, you will have rich and poor, but there are points in the city where you can feel equal. And I think those equal places are high quality urban spaces, not for cars, but for people. And I think the concept of the police, of the agora, was here in Athens, where it didn't matter who you were, you had a say. And if you create quality space, I mean, this is the background where members of parliament were fighting against the playground because they thought the mayor was crazy talking to children, and children don't vote, children don't pay taxes. And the question for me is, are we worrying about the next election or are we worrying about the next generation? And my answer is we should worry about the next generation, because if we take care of the children, the likelihood of the next election is also positive.
We're living a lot outside, as I can see, from the pitch.
Say again?
You're living a lot outside, out of the buildings, I mean, to the parks, to the fields.
Because I think institutions, by definition, whether it's the Prime Minister's office or whether it's the Mayor's office, you're surrounded by advisors and by bodyguards and by people who try to shield you from reality. And I think you cannot make good decisions unless you hit the ground and you are in the physical space with people that can give you this energy and can give you this feedback. And this is what I love about my job. I used to have other jobs before when I was...
One last question. Tirana can be a smart city, comparing with other European capitals, I mean.
That's a very good question. What is smart? I was in an event earlier, and someone approached me and said, Mr. Mayor, you are progressive. We have exactly the right product for you. And I said, what is the product? Oh, it's the best product for a smart city. I said, show me. So it looks like a panel, like one of these panels from the Berlin Wall. It has that sort of that. And he said, you put this in your pavement in the city. You put it in the plug. It has some fungus. You can, it's like a respirator. It takes away carbon and it produces oxygen. I said, what a great invention. How much does this cost? And the guy says, oh, it costs 250,000 euros for you because you are our friend. And I said, where are you guys from? I said, we're from Germany. I don't know in Germany, but in Albania, the thing that takes carbon and produces oxygen, it's called a tree, and it doesn't cost so much. So the question about the smart city is not overwhelming the city with gadgets, but it's overwhelming the city with common sense. And sometimes being smart means not reinventing hot water. If trees are the best capture of carbon and the best canopy for shade in hot summers like Athens and Tirana, let's do more of what nature has already produced. Now, of course, do we pay our parking with mobiles? Of course. Do we have apps where people can say, this is a pothole that needs to be filled, this is a pile of trash that you haven't picked up, this is a tree that was broken by the flood? Absolutely. But it should never, never overwhelm common sense.
The time is over. Thank you so much, Mr. Mayor. See you again.
Thank you so much.
Θυμίζω απλώς στο ακροατήριο ότι ο σημερινός Πρωθυπουργός, ο Έντι Ράμα, ξεκίνησε από τον Δήμο Τυράννων. Κρατήστε το και θα δούμε τι θα συμβεί στο μέλλον. Thank you.
Ευχαριστώ.
Καλή συνέχεια στην επόμενη συνεδρία του Olympia Forum.